This module will cover different types of tissues and membranes within the human body. Once completed with this module, you should be able to list different types of tissues and membranes within the human body. In a previous module, we discussed levels of organization within the body. Tissues are one particular level of organization whereby specific cells with similar structure and functions are joined together to perform a specific function within the body. Generally speaking, there are several different types of tissues within the body, all of which fall within specific broad categories. The first of which is epithelial tissue. This type of tissue is very common throughout the body as it forms the covering of body surfaces, lines body cavities and hollow organs, and is the major tissue in glands. Epithelial tissue is built from cells that fit tightly together, which forms a tightly packed layer of cells with very little, if any, space between the cells. These epithelial tissues serve various functions that include protection of the underlying body surface, secretion, absorption, excretion, filtration, diffusion, and sensory reception. Epithelial tissue generally lacks vascular structures, meaning it does not receive its own blood supply. Rather, oxygen and nutrients are provided to the cells within epithelial tissues via diffusion from other nearby tissue cells, such as connective tissue. We will look at different types of epithelial tissues in just a little bit. Another major category of body tissues is connective tissue. Connective tissue is the most prevalent and widely distributed type of tissue throughout the body. These tissues bind body structures together, form a supportive framework for organs and the body as a whole, store fat, produce blood cells, transport substances such as fluids and dissolved materials, repair other tissues, and protect against disease and infection. Unlike epithelial tissues, connective tissues have cells that are not densely spaced, resulting in what is known as a large intercellular matrix that typically includes extracellular material produced by the connective tissue cells. Most connective tissues also have a good blood supply and require significant nourishment. Common types of connective tissues will be the focus of this presentation in a few slides. Muscle tissue is another major category of tissues within the body. These tissues have the special ability to forcibly contract, shorten, and relax, lengthen, to produce movement. Given this function, muscle tissues are often referred to as contractile tissue. Muscle tissue is highly cellular and well supplied by blood. We will look at the three different types of muscle tissue later in this presentation. Lastly, neural or nervous tissue conducts electrical impulses for the purpose of coordinating and controlling body activities, such as stimulating muscle contraction, providing feedback from the environment, governing emotions, supporting reasoning, and retention of memories. These tissues are found within the brain, spinal cord, and peripheral nerves. Given that brief overview of various tissues within the human body, we can now delve deeper into specific types of tissues, starting with epithelial tissues. Simple squamous epithelial tissue is comprised of a single layer of thin, flat cells, and such tissue is located in the alveoli of the lungs, where it permits the diffusion of oxygen and carbon dioxide between the air in the lungs and the blood. The kidneys, for filtrating water and electrolytes, and this kind of tissue also lines the walls of capillaries and lymphatic vessels to facilitate absorption by diffusion, filtration, and osmosis. Stratified squamous epithelial tissue is comprised of multiple layers of cells designed to protect underlying body structures. These tissues are located on the outer layer of the skin, as well as the surface lining of the mouth, esophagus, vagina, and anus. Simple cuboidal epithelial tissue is built from a single layer of cells that are essentially cube-shaped, being as wide as they are tall. As a lining for the kidney tubules, this tissue supports the absorption of water and electrolytes. Where it lines the surface of the ovaries, the salivary glands, thyroid gland, and pancreas, simple cuboidal epithelial tissue facilitates the secretion of enzymes and hormones. Stratified cuboidal epithelial tissue is comprised of cube-shaped cells like simple cuboidal tissue, but these cells are in two layers, not one, which provides protection for underlying structures by serving as a lining for larger mammary gland ducts, sweat gland ducts, and salivary glands. Simple columnar epithelial tissue consists of a single layer of cells that are taller than they are wide. These tissues line the stomach and intestines and serve to protect those structures while also facilitating the secretion of digestive enzymes and absorption of nutrients within the gastrointestinal tract. Some of the cells within this type of tissue may even be equipped with little hairs known as cilia, which then makes the tissue ciliated. Such ciliated tissue lines portions of the respiratory tract, and the cilia will move foreign particles out of the lungs. If you have not noticed a recurring theme yet, there is also a stratified columnar epithelial tissue that has those thinner and longer cells stacked together into multiple layers for the purposes of protection and secretion. Such tissues exist in large ducts within some glands, part of the pharynx, and part of the male urethra. Pseudostratified columnar epithelial tissue has a single layer of cells that are different heights. As a lining for the trachea, most of the upper respiratory passages, and the male urethra, these tissues provide protection and also the secretion of mucus. When lining the fallopian tubes, these tissues are responsible for moving the egg toward the uterus. Lastly, transitional epithelial tissues fluctuate between simple when stretched and stratified when not stretched. Aside from providing protection of underlying structures, transitional tissues can stretch and change appearance to look like other epithelial tissues. These tissues line the inside of the urinary bladder, the ureters, and part of the urethra. As far as connective tissues are concerned, they are often categorized based upon their physical properties. The first type is called connective tissue proper, which is comprised of a variety of cell types and protein fibers suspended in what is typically a viscous, syrupy ground substance. This category is further divided into dense and loose connective tissue. Dense connective tissue is reinforced by bundles of collagen fibers that provides tensile strength, elasticity, and protection. These dense connective tissues usually have a poor blood supply and, as a result, take considerable time to repair. Ligaments and tendons are an example of such tissues, as is the dermis of the skin. Dense connective tissue is also what gives arterial walls their strength and ability to return to their original shape after stretching. Dense connective tissue is categorized into either regular or irregular dense connective tissue. Dense, regular connective tissue has fibers that run parallel to each other, which enhances tensile strength of the tissue while restricting stretching in the direction of the fiber's orientation. Dense, irregular connective tissue fibers, on the other hand, have fibers that run in random directions, which enhances the overall strength of the tissue. Loose connective tissues have fibers that are loosely organized, leaving large spaces in between. Areolar tissue has cells and fibers distributed in a random, web-like fashion, and it binds skin to underlying organs, fills spaces between muscle fibers, holds body fluids, supports organs in the abdominal cavity, and surrounds blood and lymph vessels. Adipose tissue predominantly consists of fat cells with little extracellular matrix. Adipose tissue can be found beneath the skin, between muscles, around the kidneys, behind the eyes, on the surface of the heart, around some of the joints, and in some abdominal membranes. In addition to storing energy in the form of fat, adipose tissue also provides cushioning for nearby body parts. Reticular loose connective tissue is a mesh-like supportive tissue that provides a framework for soft internal organs such as the spleen and liver. Supportive connective tissue essentially provides structure and strength to the body while also protecting soft tissues. Such supportive connective tissue is found in the form of cartilage and bone. Cartilage is tough but flexible tissue that exists in joints, the end of the ribs, between vertebrae in the spine, in the ears and nose, and within bronchial tubes and airways. The purpose is to protect the body and its components from the forces of compression and tension. Cartilage is harder than dense connective tissue, but is softer than bone. Cartilage also lacks nerve fibers. As with dense connective tissue, cartilage has a limited blood supply and takes time to heal if damaged. Cartilage is further broken down into three categories. Hyaline cartilage is smooth and firm. It is a low-friction, wear-resistant tissue found within joints, the nose, and respiratory passages. It is strong and flexible, often described as rubbery, but has poor regenerative capacity. Hyalogen cartilage is important for bone growth and is the most prevalent type of cartilage in the body. Elastic cartilage has greater flexibility than hyaline cartilage and is found in the ear, larynx, and epiglottis. Fibrocartilage is tough and inflexible. It absorbs shock within the spinal columns, the knees, and the pelvic girdle. Another supportive connective tissue that was already mentioned briefly is bone. Bone is the most rigid type of connective tissue in the body, comprised of a rigid and calcified matrix of densely packed fibers. Bone tissue provides protection to internal organs and also provides support and structure to the body. The outside of bones is comprised of compact bone, which is the harder exterior layer that provides protection and strength to the bones. Within the bones is cancellous bone tissue, which reduces the density of bone and allows the ends of long bones to compress as a result of applied stress. The last type of connective tissue to discuss may not actually strike you as a tissue given its form and the fact that it does not connect structures or provide support. Fluid connective tissue is the fourth type of connective tissue that includes blood and lymph. These fluids are considered connective tissue because the cells circulate in an extracellular matrix that allows for the transportation of nutrients, oxygen, and waste products. Muscle tissues are classified by their anatomic location and function. The first type of muscle tissue is smooth muscle tissue. Also known as non-striated involuntary muscle tissue or unstriated muscle tissue, the cells within the tissue are long, spindle-shaped, and reside within hollow internal organ walls. These muscle tissues are called involuntary because they typically cannot be controlled through conscious thought or effort. These tissues are responsible for constricting the lumen of blood vessels, moving fluid through the body, processing and digesting food, and eliminating waste products. Smooth muscle tissue can be found in the intestines, stomach, esophagus, blood vessels, and uterus. In contrast, skeletal muscle tissue is usually under voluntary control of the person through conscious thought or effort. These cells are striated, meaning they are marked by transverse dark and light bands with multiple nuclei in each cell. The name skeletal is used because these muscle cells attach to bones, the skeletal system, with tendons and are responsible for movement. Skeletal muscles are located throughout the body and are also known to bleed considerably if damaged, given their significant blood supply. The last type of muscle tissue is cardiac muscle tissue. Also known as myocardium, this tissue is the contractile layer of the heart wall responsible for pumping blood throughout the body. Cardiac muscle tissue is similar to skeletal tissue in that it is striated. Beyond that, however, the similarities end, as cardiac cells commonly have only one, maybe two nuclei. They are tightly connected through structures known as intercalated discs, and their contraction is not under conscious control. Rather, contraction is stimulated by the heart's electrical conduction system. Neural or nervous tissues provide a pathway for electrical conduction that allows body structures and control functions to communicate. Neural tissues contain two types of cells: neurons, which are responsible for receiving and sending electrical impulses and signals to each other and other tissues, and neuroglia, or glial cells, which are supportive cells that provide protection, nourishment, and insulation to the tissue. We will delve into the structure and functioning of nerve cells in considerable depth within the nervous system module. For the time being, this broad overview of neural tissue composition will suffice for the objective of this module. Membranes are thin sheets of tissue that cover the body, serve as linings for body cavities, and cover organs within those body cavities. Such membranes consist of either connective tissue or epithelial tissue and the connective tissue to which it is attached. Essentially, membranes form a barrier or serve as an interface between organs. Mucous membranes, sometimes referred to as mucosae, line body cavities that open to the outside. The digestive tract is lined with mucous membranes, as are many surfaces in the respiratory, excretory, and reproductive systems. Serous membranes line body cavities that do not open directly to the outside of the body. They also cover the organs located within those cavities. The thoracic cavity is lined with the parietal pleura membrane, and the lungs are covered with the visceral pleura membrane. There is actually a serous fluid secreted by these membranes to provide lubrication and reduce friction and abrasion between these membranes. There is a pericardium membrane that surrounds the heart, and there is a peritoneum membrane that surrounds the organs in the abdomen. Another very important membrane that actually is an organ in and of itself is the skin, otherwise known as the cutaneous membrane, which covers the surface of the body, thus protecting the internal environment from the external world. Synovial membranes are connective tissue membranes that line the cavities around freely movable joints such as the knee, shoulder, and elbow. These membranes are obviously closed to the outside world. They are contained within the body and do not open to the outside, and they secrete synovial fluid into the joint cavity to provide lubrication to the cartilage on the ends of the bones to support the free movement of those joints with as little friction as possible between the bones. While these membranes may sound similar to serous membranes, they are different in that they do not have a layer of epithelium. Synovial membranes consist of connective tissue only. There are also numerous special connective tissues within the body, including the meninges, which protect the brain and spinal cord within the skull and dorsal cavity, periosteum tissue, which surrounds mature bone, perichondrium tissue, which surrounds developing bone, superficial fascia tissue, which is a general coating for the body beneath the skin made up of areolar tissue and varying amounts of fat that helps determine the shape of the body, and deep fascia, which is a dense fibrous connective tissue that surrounds muscles, bones, nerves, and blood vessels. That completes our brief exploration of the tissues and membranes of the body. As we explore the anatomy and physiology of individual body systems in later modules, we'll begin with the basic principles discussed in this module and then delve much deeper into the cells and functioning within these various types of tissues. For the time being, however, you should now be able to list the types of tissues and membranes within the human body. This presentation was prepared by Waukesha County Technical College in Pewaukee, Wisconsin, and is distributed with an attribution, non-commercial, share-alike 4.0 International Creative Commons license. Copyright 2021 Waukesha County Technical College. For information on WCTC's numerous fire and EMS educational offerings, please visit us online at wctc.edu.